Good morning. We have general questions. Question one, Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether planning regulations can be adapted to allow more housing in the countryside.
Cabinet Secretary Alex Neil.
Presiding Officer, Scottish planning policy requires that development plans make provision for rural housing in accordance with the spatial strategy for the area. Policies can be adapted to suit local needs and circumstances.
Rob Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In the Stage 1 report, the Land Reform Bill has shown that social rural housing is needed across Scotland, and planners have been allowed to group houses in village envelopes to make it easier to supply utilities. But the real needs are for houses for tenant farmers and crofters to allow retirement of agriculturalists on the spot in the places where they live and work. Will the Scottish Government ensure that planning meets real needs, not planning theories unsuited to much of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I've got a great deal of sympathy with the point the member makes, and absolutely our view is that planning authorities should accommodate the needs of people as expressed. Obviously, we have the independent planning review being undertaken at the present time, and I would hope that the planning review will address this matter in its report, which should be due sometime early in the new year.
Cameron Buchanan.
Thank you. It's quite right that we need more housing, and to make it happen, we need to ensure that planning regulations are not overzealous. What analysis has the Scottish Government done on planning systems elsewhere that take less time to make decisions?
Presiding Officer, we always look for best practice through our own offices as well as the professional bodies representing the planning industry in Scotland. And obviously, one of the aspects of the independent planning review will be to receive evidence on where things work better elsewhere and what we can learn from other regimes. We've never taken the view that we get everything absolutely right in Scotland. We can always learn from other people, and that applies to planning as it does to other aspects of policy.
Question number two, John Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met NHS Ayrshire and Arran to discuss primary care out of our services.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
The report of findings and recommendations of the National Review of Primary Care Out of Our Services was published on Monday the 30th of November, and the purpose of the review was to ensure that out of our services were patient-centred, safe and sustainable as part of our wider reforms of primary care. NHS Ayrshire and Arran representatives contributed to the review, and the review chair and review team from the Scottish Government visited NHS Ayrshire and Arran on the 26th of June of this year as part of the review's national engagement programme. Officials will continue to be in contact with NHS Ayrshire and Arran as we move into implementing the recommendations of the review, and I have recently met the chair and chief executive.
John Scott.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that a significant number of GPs in Ayrshire are approaching retirement age. She will also be aware of the difficulty in recruiting young doctors to become GPs in Ayrshire, particularly in the rural areas. The recent suggestion of university bias against such a career path not helping the situation. Given the likely lack of GP availability for these and other reasons, how does she see a doctor-led out-of-hour service being delivered in Ayrshire in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, the member will be aware these were all of the pertinent matters which Sir Lewis Ritchie dealt with in his very, very good report. And he pointed the way to essentially a multidisciplinary team solution, not just in Ayrshire and Arran, but across Scotland, with the focus around the urgent care resource hubs, where urgent care is coordinated from the one place. Now, this was with an out-of-hours context, but it has an in-hours application as well. The member will, I'm sure, be aware of the nurse-led pilot in Ayrshire. And I can tell him that over 2,500 patients were referred to the Ayrshire Out of Hours service, and half of them were referred to advanced nurse practitioners. Now, the role of the GP within these multidisciplinary teams will be as a clinical expert supporting the multidisciplinary team. But from the feedback of that pilot in Ayrshire, the feedback is very, very positive indeed. And I think it leads the way of how a multidisciplinary team can work to bolster and improve out of our services.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think the pilot actually is excellent, and I think we would all commend the work that's being done, but obviously demand pressures are increasing all the time on the health service. Can the Cabinet Secretary please tell the Chamber how many more patients are now being treated annually by primary out of our services in NHS Ayrshire and Arran since the SNP came to office in 2007?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the number of patients being treated across the whole of the NHS has continued to increase. Out of hours is no exception to that. I'll write to the member with the patient numbers for Ayrshire and Arran. But that's why, of course, we need to ensure the sustainability of out of hours services going forward, which is why the report from Sir Lewis Ritchie is so timely and so pertinent, because it shows that with the right workforce model, with the right multidisciplinary team, we can provide robust out of hours services to what will be a growing number of patients. And also, if we get that right, we can avoid patients going to other parts of the health system, which is obviously something we want to do.
Richard Simpson, can I just point out it's about NHS Ayrshire and Arran and primary care?
Yes, it's the. Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's responses and also welcome the Sir Lewis Ritchie report, which is obviously critical to care in Ayrshire and Arran and elsewhere going forward. But could I ask her, in the meantime, while we're setting up new pilots for the Sir Lewis Ritchie model, of which Ayrshire and Arran again has got one of the possible pilots, could I ask her to take a look at the problems that are occurring in the Ayrshire and Arran and other areas in relation to transport of patients to the more limited number of out-of-hours centres, such as is occurring in Lanarkshire and Tayside?
Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. Well, obviously we have a debate on primary care next week where we'll be able to explore these issues in more detail. But, you know, we will require, while the rollout of the report recommendations is happening, we will require boards to maintain a robust and sustainable set of out-of-hours arrangements as we move towards a different model of delivery of out-of-hours. I'm happy to ensure that Richard Simpson gets an update on the transport issue in advance of the debate next week.
Question number three, Angus MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it's had with the road haulage industry regarding reported driver shortages.
Minister Derek McCann.
The Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, Skills and Training met with the Scottish Road Haulage Group to discuss this matter in March, and this was followed by a meeting with officials in June. My officials also met with Lantra and the Road Haulage Association in the past 2 months. Skills Development Scotland have been working with the road freight industry partners on developing an invitation to quote for research aimed at gathering evidence on the scale of the shortage in Scotland. The invitation to quote for this work is expected to issue shortly and will inform the development of a skills investment plan for the industry. Finally, I would encourage employers to consider the potential for recruiting former members of the armed forces into the haulage industry, many of whom who will have received the industry-relevant training and experience which could give them a head start in securing the civilian qualifications they need.
Angus MacDonald.
I thank the Minister for his reply and I welcome the action taken to date by Skills Development Scotland. Is the Minister willing to discuss with the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, Skills and Training the possibility of working in partnership with haulage firms to share the costs of training new drivers, not just in the general haulage sector, but also in the specialised livestock haulage sector where there is a specific shortage?
Minister.
Yes, I'm very happy to initiate those discussions and report back to Mr MacDonald.
Thank you. Questions 4 and 5 have not been lodged. In both cases, the members have provided an explanation. Question number 6, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to promote self-help as a form of preventative care.
Minister Maureen Watt.
The 2020 Vision for Health and Social Care focuses on prevention, anticipation and supported self-management. We need to ensure that people can live and die well with whatever health conditions they have. We are working with the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland. The Alliance developed our self-management strategy, Gone Your Cell, and administers the £2 million per annum self-management fund. Our world-leading health literacy action plan, Making It Easy, supports people to be in the driving seat of their care by building their skills and confidence to use health information. This sits at the heart of our commitment to deliver a safe, effective and person-centred healthcare system.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank the Minister for that response. The one-stop shop in Inverness offers a range of services to adults with autistic spectrum disorder. Because of delays in the budget this year, they're very concerned about the future of the service in Inverness. Can I ask the Minister, can the one-stop shop and its clients continue to count on the support of the Scottish Government, and when will they be told if their funding will continue?
Minister.
Well, of course, the one-stop shop in Inverness, like one-stop shops for people on, with autistic spectrum disorders, is a matter for health boards. They will be the ones who fund it. But personally, I think they deliver an excellent service. I visited the one in Aberdeen, and I think that they do a marvellous job, and I would hope that health boards would continue to fund them.
Question number 7, Hanzala Malik.
Thank you very much and good afternoon, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether the savings arising from renegotiating of the price of new hepatitis C medicines will be used to increase the number of people receiving treatment.
Minister Morimont.
Our sexual health and bloodborne virus framework, which we published this September, committed us to increasing annual hepatitis C treatment targets to 1,500. However, we were also clear that we would keep that target under review as the price of therapies changed and as more treatments came to the market. The treatment and therapies group, which we established to provide us with expert advice on these matters, will meet later this month to discuss recent developments in this respect. It includes members from NHS boards, procurement and patient organisations. We will consider carefully any advice the group provides.
Hanzala Malik.
Thank you very much for that response. The Scottish Government recently committed to the elimination of hepatitis C as a public health concern. While this is welcome, in order to do this, we must increase even further the number of people being diagnosed and treated. Will the Minister consider establishing a working group within the new sexual health and bloodborne vessels framework to investigate exactly what steps we need to take to eliminate the virus, given the importance of ensuring this commitment is realised?
Minister.
The member is, of course, correct that we want to eliminate Hep C in Scotland, and the number that we are treating has been welcomed by all those involved in the industry. As I said, we do have the treatment and therapies group, of which we rely on advice, and we'll look forward to their next report.
Question number 8, Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to assist farmers in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government supports farmers in a range of different ways. We provide around £500 million, £500 million per annum through direct support through the new Common Agricultural Policy, which for the first time will have access for new entrants, and have coupled support schemes for both beef and sheep producers. And the Scottish Rural Development Programme supports around 11,000 farmers and crofters through the LFAS scheme and the new multi-million pound beef efficiency scheme we're introducing as well. These schemes seek to support Scottish agriculture and to ensure the sector has a profitable and sustainable future.
Dennis Robertson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. At a recent meeting at Thainston in my constituency, I met with farmers and suppliers. They're expressing their concern that the banks maybe not taking overdraft and bridging loans for suppliers in particular. They haven't met with the suppliers to look at this overdraft facility. And I know the Cabinet Secretary has met with the farming and banking to look at this. What can you do to allay their fears and concerns with overdraft facilities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, and we share Dennis Robertson's concerns over the cash flow issues facing many Scottish farmers and crofters. For that reason, I recently met RBS, Clydesdale Bank, Bank of Scotland, HSBC, to discuss with them the relationship with our farmers at the moment. They all gave me an assurance they're standing by the sector at this time, and if any individual farmers have any particular problems, they should alert their local bank as soon as possible. If there are any instances that Dennis Robertson can make available from speaking to his constituents, please let me have them and I'll discuss them directly with the banks.
Jamidi. You press your button, Mr. Reedy. I take it you don't want to ask about farmers. Not many in your constituency then. Question number 9, Fiona MacLeod.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what guidance is available to planning authorities to ensure that equalities are central to the decision-making process.
Cabinet Secretary Alex Neil.
Presiding Officer, equality is integrated throughout Scottish planning legislation and guidance. A core value of the planning service is that it should be inclusive, engaging all interests as early and as effectively as possible.
Fiona MacLeod.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I highlight to the Cabinet Secretary the petition that was submitted to Parliament on the 3rd of December by East Dumbartonshire Visually Impaired People's Forum? It was about shared space schemes, which includes the Catherine Street Junction in my constituency. And in that petition, they refer to the lack of consideration by East Dumbartonshire Council of the proposal on the visually and mobility impaired. Is there any advice that the Cabinet Secretary can give to the group?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am aware of the petition and confirm that officials have listened to the concerns of representatives from local disability groups. In general, shared space schemes can be appropriate in some settings to put people in place before the movement of motor vehicles, but the decision is very much for a local decision-making and local authorities on a case-by-case basis. But very clearly, this group and people like them should be given every opportunity to ensure that the space allocation within their community is absolutely adequate to their needs.
Cameron Buchanan.
Thank you. What new efforts have the Scottish Government made to work with local planning authorities to avoid the all-too-common scenario where local decisions are appealed but overturned centrally?
I'm not sure that that's entirely relevant. Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that people, it has been expressed from guide dogs as well, that people with significant visual impairments and those with dementia and other mobility problems as well cannot orientate through shared spaces because they have no significant landmarks?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, Presiding Officer, I'm very, very aware of the problem. In fact, I was this morning launching the official new place standard tool, which will help local authorities and others to address some of these issues. And I think the point that Dennis Robertson raises is a very valid one, and one that every planning authority, indeed every department of every authority, including central government, should take full account of.
Question number 10, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to adjust the Common Agricultural Policy greening measures so that they can be implemented in the clearest way for farmers without jeopardising environmental benefits.
Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead.
In Brussels next week, I will meet representatives from the European Commission to explain why their greening requirements, in particular the three crop rule, is not compatible with Scottish agriculture and why common sense must prevail to enable our farmers to choose alternative measures through what are known as the equivalence rules.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. There is still concern, as highlighted to me at the Forth and Clyde meeting, regional meeting for NFUS, and I'm very concerned particularly about a range of issues, but particularly about the grazing on ecological focus area buffer zones and the confusion expressed to me about where farmers are not able to graze because you have made the decision not to implement the grazing rule, and how the double where there are water, where there are buffers for watercourses, that beyond that there's also the confusion about whether ecological focus area has to be added to that or whether it can be part of the same buffer.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there are three elements to the European rules on greening: the new common agricultural policy, and 30% of the payments are dependent on farmers meeting those conditions. Where we've had some influence over flexibility in terms of how we implement these in Scotland, we have worked closely with the sector. If there's a specific concern that has been expressed to Claudia Beamish, I'd ask her to contact my office, and I'm happy to meet her, because it sounds quite a technical issue, but I'd be happy to learn more about it and see what we could do. Thank you.
Thank you. That ends general questions. I'm now moving straight.